Can you, is it a... Okay. Yeah, just pull it out. You have to pull it up a bit, or? No, because I can pull it up. Yeah. Oh, look, there's a space in the front line. You can come see. This is not for special people. The Ru'asa. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله وكفى بالله شهيدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له إقرارا به وتوحيدا. وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم تسليما مزيدا أما بعد. So inshallah ta'ala, the talk of today will be about the virtues of Al-Quran. كتاب الله تبارك وتعالى. And I'll be reading from the khutbah of الشيخ الوالد الإمام العلامة صالح الفوزان حفظه الله تعالى. So the Sheikh mentioned, إن هذا القرآن الذي بين أيدينا يسره الله لنا هو حبل الله المتين وصراطه المستقيم. He mentioned that the Quran that is with us or in our hands, Allah made it easy for us, meaning to memorize it. As Allah تبارك وتعالى mentioned, ولقد يسرنا القرآن للذكر فهل من مدكر. We have made Quran easy to be memorized. We have made the Quran easy to be memorized. And he mentioned, وَهُوَ حَبْلُ اللَّهِ الْمَتِينَ. That is the strong, the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the strong one. وَصِرَاطُهُ الْمُسْتَقِيمُ. And it is a straight path. So if you want to follow the straight path of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, then it's upon us to follow the Quran, the book of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Man tamassaka bihi naja. Man tamassaka bihi naja. Wa man a'radha anhu halak. Whoever holds firmly onto the Quran will be successful and will be saved. And whoever turns away from it and abandons the Quran will be destroyed. Will be destroyed. فلا ينجو من عذاب الله ولا يفوز برحمة الله إلا من تمسك بهذا القرآن العظيم فلا ينجو من عذاب الله. No one will be saved from the punishment of Allah. ولا يفوز برحمة الله. And no one will receive Allah's mercy. إلا من تمسك بهذا القرآن العظيم. Except the one that hold firmly onto the book of Allah تبارك وتعالى. Allah mentioned the Quran, إن هذا القرآن يهدي للتي هي أقوم. That this Quran guide to that which is أقوم, upright. Upright. So before we start mentioning some ahadith and verse about the virtues of the Quran, firstly, the Quran was revealed upon the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wa salam. And the Quran is the mu'jiz al-uzma, is the great, the greatest miracle. So al-Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam, through him Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala challenged the people to bring something in the Quran. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam to the people, to call people to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or selected him as the messenger of Allah and the Prophet of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he gave him mu'jiza. Because every prophet and messenger has had a mu'jiza to challenge the people with. For example, as Imam ibn Kathir, may Allah have mercy upon him, said, at the time of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, they were known for what? What were known for? They were for sihr, for magic. for sihr. طيب. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave a mu'jiza to Musa alayhi salatu wa salam. It's not sihr. No, it's not sihr. But it's something which is similar, that changing something to something else. But the sihr is not real. When he says it's not real, meaning what the people saw when the sticks turned into snakes, that was just tricks. طيب. Musa alayhi salatu wa salam, when Allah gave him that mu'jiza, when the stick turned into actual big snake and ate those sticks, the best magicians at that time, they knew what Musa alayhi salatu wa salam did. It was beyond human capacity. It's not from the human nature to come with this type of thing. That's why what they did, they believed in Musa alayhi salatu wa salam. The time of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam, he was in a time when the people they were known for what? Who they were known for? Astronomy. Okay. They were known for debate. One of the mu'jiza, they were known for, they were very good at debating. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Ibrahim alayhi salam skills of debating that he was able to refute and expose and debunk all those people that were facing him. Of course, Allah gave him the other mu'jiza, which is there. Allah saved him from the fire. Kuni burden wa salaman ala Ibrahim. That be safe, kuni burden. Be cold and cool. The ulama said, if Allah should say to be cold, then it will become very freezing. You know, he said, be cold and be cool. The time of Isa alayhi salam, the time of Jesus, Isa alayhi salam, what they were known for? Medicine. They were very good at it. They were very good at it, very advanced. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the mu'jiza gave to Isa alayhi salam is bringing dead people to life. So people knew that it's beyond human capacity. What Isa alayhi salam was doing is beyond human capacity. The time of the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam, the people were known for eloquency, for poems, shi'r. They had like a market. They were known for this type of market. At that time, they were known, the poets would come from different areas, from the Arab Peninsula or from Sham, come, start challenging one another. So they used to, and remember, the Arabs, العرب ما كان عندهم كتاب من قبل هذا. They never had the books before that. They used to rely heavily on their what? Their memories. They used to memorize poems that consist of hundreds of lines. Hundreds of lines, and they used to make it on a spot. Subhanallah, look. Dude, they were very good at it. Subhanallah. So they used to challenge one another. But when the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, Allah sent him with the Quran and started reciting, they tried to say it's a shi'r, they tried to lie, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenged them. You are the people of lugha, you are people of language, you are eloquent, you are masters in language, you are poets, so bring something like it. They went silent. As Ibn al-Qayyim, may Allah have mercy upon him, mentioned, he said, the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam challenged them to bring something of the Quran. And the challenge was many times. It was one in Mecca and one in Medina, two times in Mecca, two times in Medina. So what they did, they did not accept the challenge. Instead, what they did, they waged a war against him. But we know when you're in a war, you're going to lose wealth, money, souls, lives, and so on. So why they choose war? And we know war is the hardest one. Generally speaking, like from dunya perspective, war is hardest. You're going to kill, you're going to put yourself in danger. So why did not challenge, why did not accept the challenge? Because they knew the hardest one was a challenge, not the war. They knew it's better off for them to not accept the challenge because they will look silly. Because the Quran they knew is not from the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenged him in Surah Al-Baqarah. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْبٍ مِمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِنْ مِثْلِهِ وَادْعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ فَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا وَلَنْ تَفْعَلُوا فَاتَّقُوا النَّارَ الَّتِي وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ أُعِدَّتْ لِلْكَافِرِينَ. That if you are in doubt about that which we have sent down upon our prophets, our servants, they bring something like it and they bring your witnesses. And if you cannot do it, and you will never be able to do it. You will never be able what? To do it. That is a prophecy in the Quran. And that cannot come from human being that if I make up something and I know people in the future probably, how he knew that no one will be able to make it even in the future? To make something like it. Now the challenge has been for how long? 1,500 years. Yet no one accepts the challenge. There were some people they did, to be honest, but wallahi, they humiliated themselves. The language they came with, even beginners in the Arabic language, they knew that it's very bad, you know. The grammar is very bad, clear mistakes. So the Quran is a miracle in its eloquency, in its wording, the prophecies, the legislation, and so on. The shaykh, barakallahu fikum. So a Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam challenged them. A person might say, maybe he challenged them once. Maybe did not hear him. No, he went and he kept challenging them. Bring something like it. أَمْ يَقُولَ تَقَوَّلَهُ Or they say he forged it. Then bring something like it. Then Medina, قُلْ لَإِنْ اجْتَمَعَتْ Then Ibn Taymiyyah, may Allah have mercy upon him, said, how Allah finished the challenge with, قُلْ لَإِنْ اجْتَمَعَتْ الْإِنْسُ وَالْجِنُّ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَأْتُوا بِمِثْلِ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ لَا يَأْتُونَ بِمِثْلِهِ وَلَوْ كَانَ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ ظَهِيرًا Now say to them, O Muhammad, the meaning of the verse, say to them, if whole mankind, not just you, people of Quraysh, or the people of the Arabic language, no, the whole Bani Adam, whole mankind, and not just mankind, even a jinn kind, if they come together, help one another, and try to produce something in the Quran, they will never be able to do so. And that is not a statement of a normal human being. That is a statement of the creator of Bani Adam, the creator of everything. So the Quran, as we have mentioned, is a mu'jiza. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenged them. Likewise, when you look to the ghaybiyat in the Quran, for example, one of the proofs, there's many proofs, that Quran was not made by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Nabi alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when the people accused his wife of adultery, they accused his wife of adultery. And you know, the one of the worst thing to accuse someone is to accuse him in his honor, in his earth. That you accuse him that his wife, she's an adulterer. So Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, if he was a liar, what he would have done? He could just make up anything on the spot. But for 1 month, he was going to Aisha. Oh, Aisha, is it true what they're saying? Then he went to Ali ibn Abi Talib, asking about Aisha. That's not nature of a liar. What he could have done? If he was a liar, he already made up many things. He could have made it up on the spot. Why is he going to wait 1 month, people making up things about him in his honor? He was asking Ali ibn Abi Talib, what do you think about Aisha? I don't know nothing about her except she's a good woman. He asked the other Sahaba. Then after that, Allah revealed the verses, freeing Aisha from this dirty, disgusting lie, and guess, Ummuna Aisha, may Allah please with that. Likewise, the verses of rebuking and correcting Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The story of, Ya ayyuha al-Nabiyyu lima tuharrim ma ahalla Allahu lak. Tabtaghi mardata azwajik. Wallahu ghafurun rahim. That all prophets, why you make something halal which Allah made haram? That is not, why he's going to rebuke himself? Because if people say, oh, he was wrong. He can't be prophet, no. Why Prophet Muhammad SAW was upon him to convey the message. What Allah is correcting him. And there's other verses which the ulama mentioned, for example, to show that the Quran was not forged or was made by the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. The story of Zainab bin Jahsh, remember, the Arabs, they looked at any person who marries his adopted, the ex-wife was his adopted son, is a major sin to them. That was a culture of the Arabs, yeah? So Prophet Muhammad SAW, before Islam, he took who as adopted son? Zayd ibn Haritha. Zayd ibn Haritha. He took him as adopted son. Then Allah revealed the verses that there's no adoption to the Quran. Yes, take care of the orphan, look after them, you know, bring them home, take care of them, raise them, and no doubt about that, it's good. Prophet ﷺ said, the one that takes care of orphans, he will be with me like these two in Jannah. However, you don't attribute him to yourself. Ascribe him to yourself because he has a father. So you refer him to his father. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to abolish the law or this pagan law of adoption. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose his prophet, alayhi salatu salam. And Zaynab bint Jahsh, she had a problem with her husband, Zayd ibn Haritha. Allah informed Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam they will get divorced. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when Zayd ibn Haritha came to him and told him, he said, stay with her. He said, no, stay with her. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was very heavy on him to marry this Zaynab because the Arabs, they're not going to let it go. They will utilize this and get him, alayhi salatu wasalam. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, and they got divorced, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered him to get married to Zaynab. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rebuked him for telling Zayd ibn Harith to stay with her, even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him. And Allah, Prophet conveyed that message that Allah said about him. Ummuna Aisha, she said, if Prophet wants to hide anything from the revelation, he would have hide that verse. Subhanallah. That's not the nature. That's why Ibn Taymiyyah mentioned, looking at the biography of Nabi alayhi salam, it is enough and sufficient to know this person is a messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is a messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there is many stories or many events with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the Quran, correcting Nabi alayhi salam, rebuking Nabi alayhi salam, or correcting him alayhi salam, and Prophet conveyed, Ya ayyuhan nabiyyu, يا أيها الرسول بلغ ما أنزل يا أيها الرسول بلغ ما أنزل إليك من ربك فإن لم تفعل فما بلغت رسالته والله يعصمك من الناس. This verse, Allah review this verse. O messenger of Allah, convey what Allah has revealed to you and the meaning of it, and you will not die or be killed until you convey the message, because Allah will protect you. That is a prophecy. And when this verse was revealed, Prophet Muhammad was not in a big, inside a palace or fortress, well guarded, protected. No, he was in a war. He was engaged in war. So he's more likely to be killed in a war. And Allah said to him, you'll not be killed, you'll not die until you convey the message. So he did not just convey this verse and he starts hiding in his palace, in his fortress. People say he's hiding, you know. But he was in a war. Not just that, they poisoned him and he did not die. And they put magic on him, he did not die. Until he conveyed the message, alayhi salatu wasalam. Al-yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati wa raditu lakum al-islam dina. Today I have perfected religion for you. Al-yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum. I have perfected religion for you, complete religion for you. وأتممت عليكم نعمتي, and I have bestowed my favor upon you. And I'm a pleased for Islam to be your way of life or religion. The shahid that this verse cannot be statement of someone or any human being. That is a clear prophecy, as Imam Ibn Uthaymeen, may Allah have mercy upon him, mentioned. And let me ask you, there's one proof which gives us a clear evidence that Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, the Quran, was not forged or made by Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. Who knows? Which proof is it the ulama use? That the Quran was not from the speech of Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. Huh? No, not this one. No, a proof that outside the Quran. Something looks to the hal, you look to the person, except like a situation, you analyze the person's You know, the stylish of Prophet ﷺ, how Prophet ﷺ speaks in the Sunnah. You know how Prophet ﷺ Sunnah, what Prophet ﷺ said, yeah? When you look at his speech and look at the Quran, it's a completely different style. The Quran is more eloquent. See? So the ulama said it's a clear proof that the Quran is not speech of Prophet ﷺ. Because when you look at his Sunnah, you can see that the speech of his Prophet ﷺ is completely different than speech of the speech in the Quran. Subhanallah. So, anyway, there's many proofs the ulama mentioned about the Quran is not from Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, وَلَا يَنْصُرَنَّ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَنْصُرُهُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَقَوِيٌّ عَزِيزٌ الَّذِينَ إِن مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَوُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَأَمَرُوا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَنَهُوا عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. So this verse is another prophecy that Allah is mentioning here. Allah will give victory to those who follow Allah's commandments and follow Allah's teaching in general, yeah? Commandment and stay away from His prohibitions, yeah? And Allah mentioned, الَّذِينَ إِن مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ. For those, if we establish them upon the earth, they will establish the prayer and give zakat and enjoy good and forbid the evil. We know historically speaking, this verse when it was revealed, Prophet ﷺ was weak. The Muslims were weak. They were in Mecca or Medina. Then after that happened, Allah fulfilled the promise. Prophet ﷺ, Allah gave him victory over his enemies. Likewise, not just his, likewise his companions. So what Allah mentions Quran came to reality. And also the verse Alif Lam Mim غلبت الروم في أدنى الأرض وهم من بعد غلبهم سيغلبون في بضع سنين. The verse of the Rome, everyone knows this prophecy. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that the Romans were defeated, but they will be victorious. بضع سنين, between 3 to 9 years. And that and this verse, the ulama mentioned, وَيَوْمَئِذٍ يَفْرَحُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Allah mentioned that. And on that day, the believers will be happy. And they said that, historically speaking, when the Persians defeated the Romans, after 9 years, the Romans defeated the Persians. It was the same time when the Muslims defeated Quraysh. So the Muslims were happy. Allah said, وَيَوْمَئِذٍ يَفْرَحُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. The believers will be happy too. And that was happened. That in that time, during that same time, the Muslim defeated the Quraysh, the Arab pagans. Likewise, the verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, سَيُهْزَمُ الْجَمْعُ يُوَلُّونَ الدُّبُرِ, that the Arab pagans, the Quraysh, they'll be defeated. And before the Battle of Badr, Nabi alayhi salam was reciting this verse. Umar al-Khattab, he said, I never understood the meaning of the verse until I heard the Messenger reciting it in the Battle of Badr. I knew that the verse means that will be defeated, mean the Quraysh. Before the battle, the Prophet ﷺ, and Prophet ﷺ, what he was doing? He was going, he said, Abu Jahl would die here. Usba ibn Rabi'ah would die here. Umayyah ibn Khalif would die here. And exactly what Prophet ﷺ pointed, they died. SubhanAllah. So as I've mentioned, there's many proofs and evidences that this book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a book, comes from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, is not from human being. And what makes Quran very special? Not like the Bible. The Bible, the people makes it special. The Quran makes the people special. Meaning, do you remember the Arab pagans, they were known to live in the middle of nowhere. They were far away from civilization. Because back then, the two great empires, the Persians and the Romans, they were far away from civilization. But when they used to buy their daughters alive. They used to wage war against each other for years over a camel. Not because of camel, subhanAllah. When Prophet ﷺ came with the Quran, Quran took them out of darkness into light. One of the best civilizations in the world, in the history, is Islamic civilization. Is Islamic civilization, and Islamic civilization was based upon the Quran and the Sunnah. The Romans who accepted Christianity, they had civilization before Bible came to them. So Bible didn't make them special. You understand? They already had civilization. But the Arabs, they had no civilization. But when the Quran came to them, Subhanallah, took them out of darkness. As they say, كانوا قواد الرعاء الغنم, they were shepherds, and they became leaders of nations because of this book. And Nabi عليه الصلاة والسلام said, إن الله يرفع بهذا الكتاب أقواما ويضع آخرين. Allah will raise people through this book and debase others. Meaning that people that follow the Quran, implement the Quran, they will be raised. And the people that oppose the Quran will be debased. So there is many virtues of the Quran. And for example, or before that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the Quran, Inna nahnu nazzalna adh-dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidun. That we will send them the Quran and we will preserve it. That is a claim, sahih? That is a claim. Can we verify this claim? We can verify this claim. We can, without any doubt. I mean, as I've mentioned before many times in my videos, in my discussions and dialogues and debates, that if the Muslims and the Jews and the Christians decide, for the sake of argument, to burn their scriptures, the only scripture will remain with us is the Quran. Because, and who can bring it back into the written form? Not the Muslim scholars, the Muslim children. They can bring it back. 100 million of Muslim children memorize the Quran, word for word, letter for letter. And that has been the case since the time Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Prophet encouraged his companions. He said, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَهُ. That's one of the virtues of the Quran. The Quran make you one of the best of the people. Prophet said, the best of you, those who learn the Quran and teaches it. Subhanallah. Learn the Quran and teaches it. And the Quran, the time of Sahaba, there were people who were known to be scholars of Quran, sit in the masjid for 30 years, 40 years teaching the Quran. That was their mission, to sit in the masjid and teach the Quran. Likewise, after Sahaba, Tabi'een, and the time of Salaf, you know, Allah would start seeking hadith, learning hadith or seeking any type of knowledge until you memorize the Quran. Subhanallah. And the Quran was recited openly in the masajid, in the houses, not like the Bible. The Bible, because remember, the Romans, they were the enemies of Christ, the Jesus followers, the true followers of Jesus. So the people were scared to recite the Injil. After that, even the Bible were not allowed for the layman people. Until recently. Maybe 500 years ago, 400. But before that, layman people were not allowed to read the Bible. It's only for the... So in order for you to understand what God wants from you, you have to go to the priest. And the priest can manipulate it because you don't know what's in there. He can tell you whatever he wants. But the Quran openly being recited, openly being taught in the masajid, in the houses. And Nabi ﷺ said, I know which houses are the houses of Al-Ash'ariyin. Al-Ash'ariyin mean the family of Abu Musa Ash'ari. Not the Ash'ari is the misguided sect. Okay. Ash'ariyin, the family of Abu Musa Ash'ari. Radiallahu arda. Oh, he's shy. How? He said, at night I can hear them reciting Quran. I can hear them reciting Quran. So the verse of Quran, so the statement or the prophecy that the Quran will be preserved, we can observe it right now. That's why they said, لا تأخذ القرآن عن مصحفي ولا تأخذ العلم عن صحفي. Do not take the Quran from مصحفي, from the Mus'haf. No, you have to have a teacher with the Quran teaching you the Quran. Because why? You have to be, you know, not just about recite, not just about preserving words, إخوة. If we preserve even the pronunciation of the المد والإضغام and so on, what about the wordings? If the scholars and the Sahaba Tabi'in, they were very cautious even how to recite and prolong the letters. Because if I say Dhalin or Dhalin, there's no problem with that. But no scholars said, no, you have to recite it this way. Subhanallah. If they were very cautious to make sure there's a way to prolong the letters, what about the letter itself? من باب الأولى, it's more so to make sure to preserve it. سبحان الله. So we look at the Quran, the book of Allah تبارك وتعالى, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, this is some muqaddimah introduction about why the Quran is a mu'jiza, why the Quran is not from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, rather it's from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, the creator of everything. Even the argument is in the Quran. The proofs and the arguments and the sharia and the nubu'at and so on, the stories of the prophets and the messengers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَتْدَبَّرُ آيَاتِ وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُ الْأَلْبَابِ. That this book, we have the meaning of the verse, كِتَابٌ, a book that we have sent down to you, blessed book. One of the reasons Allah sent down the book? For us to reflect upon it. To reflect upon it and to implement it. Not just like some people do, subhanAllah. They just put in a bookshelf or in the car to get blessings. No, you have to read it. Quran was not revealed for you to put it on a bookshelf as a beautification. No. To read it and reflect upon it. لِيَدَّبَّرُ آيَاتِ, to reflect upon it. So, and the Quran, if you want to be saved from trials and tribulations, then go back to the Quran. And the Quran, just a refutation against the Quraniyun, the so-called Quraniyun. I don't like to refer to so-called Quraniyun, yeah? Because they don't follow Quran. They are the enemies of Quran. Because in the Quran, Allah tells us to follow who? Prophet Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام. To follow the teaching of the Nabi عليه الصلاة والسلام. So when we say, when we talk about the Quran, we're talking what is in the Quran. Not just Quran. Quran is a book that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down, is a revelation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down upon his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down upon his Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wa salam is to go back to the Sunnah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the Quran, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِيمَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ. By your Lord, they will never have a belief until they make you, not make Quran, make you, O Muhammad, judge between them. So if the Quran, we don't have to go back to Sunnah, where Allah didn't say, just go back to Quran. No. Prophet, Sunnah explained the Quran. So the Quran give us a guideline, details, guideline how to understand the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and how to worship Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala by going back to the teaching of a Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam. And also another point I want to mention, that the Quran, as Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah believe, is a speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was revealed, Allah spoke with the Quran to the Prophet Muhammad, to Jibreel alayhi salatu wa salam, and Jibreel conveyed it to the Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam, and Nabi alayhi salam conveyed it to the Sahaba. And the Sahaba used to write it down, and they used to read it out to him. They used to read it out to him. So the Quran is not created. Quran is a speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the speech of Allah is an attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you're looking for cure, how many times do your people say, I'm depressed, I'm stressed? The Quran is the cure. Surah Al-Fatiha is the cure. However, you have to read it carefully, understand it, reflect upon it. And now, some brothers do ruqya, you recite the whole Surah Al-Baqarah, the whole Quran on someone and it doesn't help. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri recite one surah, Fatiha, it was enough to cure the person. Because you need someone who's sincere and someone whose heart has no barriers from accepting the medicine, the cure. You know? So, as Imam Nuqayy mentioned in his kitab, Da'wah Dawa, if you already have a barriers, you're in the Quran, but you're not even paying attention. You're not even reflecting. You're somewhere else. That will not benefit you. So the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a shifa. The Quran is being called a shifa. And the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reviewed it to likewise for the leaders to judge by it. To judge by the book of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Because there is no any problems that we are facing our time except there is a solution in the Quran. Except there is a solution in the book of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Also the Quran, anyone that memorizes the Quran will have a high levels in Jannah because of the Quran. Likewise, the Quran will become shafi' will intercede for you on the day of resurrection. The ulama mentioned, based upon the context of the hadith, meaning the reward of the Quran, not the Quran, the actual Quran, the attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the speech of Allah becomes human being. No, meaning the reward of the Quran will become what? Shafi' for you. And look at the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, at the time of Badr, when he wants to bury people, he said, bury the one who memorizes the Quran first. Who memorizes more Quran first. Shows you the fadl of Quran, the virtues of the Quran, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Quran, look at Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, the hadith of feeling depression. Allahumma inni abduka, ibnu abdika, ibnu amatik, nasiyati biyadik, madin fiyya hukmuk, adlun fiyya qadauk. أسألك بكل اسم هو لك سميت به نفسك أو أنزلته في كتابك أو علمته أحدا من خلقك أو استأثرت به في علم الغيب عندك أن تجعل القرآن العظيم ربيع قلبي ونور صدري وجلاء حزني وذهاب همي. This is dua of feeling depressed or stressed, that you make the Quran ربيع, spring for my heart, like spring upon my heart, and light, nur in my heart, and remove my depression and my stress. And when you say this dua, wallahi, by tawfiq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, every time I say this dua, stress and feeling down goes away. Look to the barakah of this dua. But what is that? What that which will remove depression is the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Read Ar-Rahman, Allama al-Qur'an, خلق الإنسان علمه البيان. That is not speech of human being, my brothers and sisters. May Allah bless you all. Human doesn't speak like that. كاف ها يا عين صاد ذكر رحمة ربك عبده زكريا إذ نادى ربه نداء خفيا قال ربي إني وهن العظم مني واشتعل الرأس شيبا ولم أكن بدعائك ربي شقيا وإني خفت الموالي من ورائي. أنت the آيات. The other صاد والقرآن ذي الذكر قاف والقرآن المجيد ألف لام ميم ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه. Look how Allah started the verse. ألف لام ميم this book, ذلك الكتاب, that book. Imam al-Shanqiti said the reason Allah referred to it with ذلك, not this is the book, ذلك, to show the magnificence and the greatness and the virtues of this Quran. لا ريب فيه. There is no doubt about it. In its ahkam, rulings, in its stories, prophecies, and legislations. لا ريب فيه. There is no doubt about it. Subhanallah. Read Surah Al-Baqarah. Read Surah Qaf. Read Surah Abasa wa Tawalla. Read Surah Amma Yatasa'alun. عن النبأ العظيم. The ulama differ. What is the meaning of النبأ العظيم? Is it the Day of Judgment or the Quran? Even the Arab pagans testify that this book, this Quran, is above them. When they ask Utbah ibn al-Walid al-Mughira, who is the Walid al-Mughira? Who is the Walid al-Mughira? Al-Walid al-Mughira is the father of Khalid. Khalid ibn al-Walid ibn al-Mughira. Khalid ibn al-Walid ibn al-Mughira, he's a father. Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira, he knew. Utbah ibn al-Rabi'ah, he knew. Umayyah ibn Khalaf, this is the head, the ru'us of the mushrikin at that time, who were the enemies of the Nabi alayhi wasallam, knew. Even the Sahabi, Mut'am ibn Jubair, the first time he heard the Quran, he had the verses of Surah At-Tur. أَمْ خُلِقُوا مِنْ غَيْرِ شَيْءٍ أَمْ هُمُ الْخَالِقُونَ أم خلقوا السماوات والأرض بل لا يوقن الأرض بل لا يوقنون. Were they created by nothing? Oh, did they create themselves? Or they create the heavens and the earth? Surely they have no firm belief. He said, the first time I heard these verses, I was a mushrik back then. He said, my heart, I felt my heart about to fly away because of the impact that verses had in my heart. You know, Umar ibn al-Khattab, the story that is famous, how he became Muslim, Taha, ما أنزلنا عليك القرآن لتشقى إلا تذكرة لمن يخشى تنزيلا ممن خلق الأرض والسماوات العلى الرحمن على العرش استوى. Look these verses. This story of Umar al-Khattab when he went to his sister's house, this story is not sahih. The sahih one, when he was walking at night in Mecca, and he heard Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam reciting the last verse of Al-Haqqa. وَمَا هُوَ بِقَوْلِ شَاعِرٍ. Because he heard Prophet Sallam recite the Quran, he said he's like a sha'ir, he's like a poem. Prophet Sallam is a poet, said. So Prophet Sallam was reciting, but he doesn't know that Umar al-Khattab is listening to him. So he recited the verse, وَمَا هُوَ بِقَوْلِ شَاعِرٍ قَلِيلًا مَا تُؤْمِنُونَ. It's not a speech of a sha'ir, little that you believe. Then he said, then Umar al-Khattab said, okay, it's a speech of a kahin. The next verse, what is it? وَلَا بِقَوْلِ كَاهِن قَلِيلًا مَا تَذَكَّرُونَ. It's not a speech of a fortune teller. Then what is the other verse? تَنْزِيلٌ مِنْ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Rather, it is a verse that was revealed from the Lord of all that which exists. That's the first time Iman entered upon the heart of Umar al-Khattab. When he heard the Quran, if the Arabs back then, the masters of the language, the best poets, they were unable to challenge the Quran. What is a funny in our time, and not funny, is a calamity, is a musibah. You hear non-Arabic speakers saying there is problem with the Quran in the Arabic language and grammar. This is a calamity, akhi. These people, you cannot speak to them anymore. They have to go to mental health care, help them first, get medicine, you know, to feel well, then speak to them. Because they cannot speak to people like that. Because they're not there mentally. So you have to get treated first, then you speak to them. You understand? That's because why? You can't even speak Arabic. Or you get some, say, Christian Arabs in Egypt. They learn the normal Arabic, the basic Arabics. That's not the Arabic, or the basic Arabic. That's not the Arabic of the Quran. So they say, oh, he said there's mistakes. Where? If the Arab, the poets, the scholars of the language back then, the masters of the language, they were unable to challenge the Quran. You come and challenge the Quran, you should feel shame of yourself. And if Abu Jahl was alive, he said, please stop embarrassing us, man. If Abu Jahl hears these people, he said, please stop it, man. Stop it, you're going to make us look bad. Subhanallah. So look at the Quran, the book of Allah, Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. So with my brothers and sisters, we are in a time, subhanallah, life is easy now. You stay at home, you order food, everything. But there's a lot of depressions. Because when you turn away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, look what Allah said, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشْتًا ضَنْكَ. Whoever turns away from my remembrance, you will have a miserable life. Everything now, you want to buy a nice car, everything. Literally, you can be at home, ordering everything. But depression. They say, do you know which countries are the most happiest countries? Sweden and Japan, yeah? Guess I'm going to, I don't know how they're happy. Do you know why? Because they have the high rate of suicide. How they happy? They're happy because they commit suicide. They have the high rate of suicide. But do you know what they said? They mean happy. They get enough, they get good salary, and they have nice houses. That's not happiness. True happiness is contentment. True happiness when you worship Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. True happiness when you know what is your purpose in this life. True happiness when you follow the guideline of the Creator, the All-Knowing, the Almighty, the Most Merciful, the Just, the Most Just. That is the true meaning of happiness. But when you turn away from that, you have a miserable life. You have confusions, misguidance, darkness. And that's what's happening in our time. When you don't have a guideline from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, the true ilah, then you'll be misguided, following desires. Today you believe this, okay, Next day you change your mind. You know, subhanAllah, because why? You have no criteria. And that's what's happened our time. Darkness. You know, people are dying because of depression. People are dying because of alcohol. People are dying because of drugs. And there is no solution except by going back to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by following Islam. Alhamdulillah, yesterday two girls became Muslims. Alhamdulillah. You know, I was speaking to the brothers because it was raining yesterday, yeah? Especially after Jumu'ah, I was in heavy. So I said to the brothers, let's go, man. Tawakkal Allah. We went, and those girls, they came to look for us. They said, we came here to look for you. I said, alhamdulillah, we came. You see people accepting Islam. Majority of people accept Islam in the Western world are women. Because they knew the true happiness and the true freedom is when you follow Allah's teaching. Wallah, my brothers and sisters, we are wasting our time on social media. And of course, you're going to feel depressed, no doubt about that. So if you want to feel happiness, open the book of Allah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. Read it. Listen to the Quran. This book is one of the big is the biggest blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon mankind by sending down this book, Kitabul Mubarak, blessed book. When the Sahaba, they never went to Oxford University, Cambridge University, Harvard University, but they took people out of darkness into light, from backwardness, true backwardness, you know, into true meaning of civilization. Subhanallah. Through what? The Quran. When they implement the Quran in their life. Now, subhanallah, people say, let me go to psychiatrist, or to go to psychologist. Go to the Quran first. Read the Quran. Reflect upon it. Subhanallah. This, the Quran, as Ali ibn Abi Talib mentioned, or I believe the author of Nabi alayhi sallam, the hadith, that the miracles of the Quran does not finish. That's why every era and every century, or every year, every era, every century, people bring more out, more from the Quran, more legislations, more fawaid benefits. Look, how many people make tafsir of Quran? How many scholars? Many scholars. Every scholar has different way of bringing fawaid. Subhanallah, from one chapter, scholars have written books, one chapter, you know, one surah. Books, fawaid. And there will be another scholars coming in the future, they will bring more fawaid. Because the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a book of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. We should appreciate that we have Quran. If a queen or a king send you a letter, you'll be every time looking at it. Imagine the book of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, the Quran. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, أَوَلَمْ يَكْفِهِمْ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, بَلْ هُوَ آيَاتٌ بَيِّنَاتٌ فِي صُدُورِ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمِ وَمَا يَجْحَدُ بِآيَاتِنَا إِلَّا الظَّالِمُونَ Rather, the Quran, it is distinct verses within the breast of those who have given knowledge. And no one deny our verse except the oppressors, the transgressors, disbelievers, the polytheists. Deny this book that is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah mentioned the meaning of the verse. Is it not sufficient for them that we have sent down this book to them? It's sufficient. They will ask for other miracles. That is a miracle, the Quran. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from the people of Quran. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us understand the Quran according to the Nabi alayhi salam and the Sahaba al-Kiram. وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وسلم سليما كثيرا. If you have any question or correction, you are more than welcome to do so. Well, the ulama mentioned about the Quran that you should have a word. Read Quran every day. Or minimum, I mention once a month. قال وقال الرسول يا وقال الرسول ربي إن قومي اتخذوا هذا القرآن مهجورا. And the Prophet said, my Lord, my people have abandoned the Quran. Ibn Qayyim mentioned, what is the meaning of abandoning the Quran? He said, one of them, not reciting it. If you don't recite it once a month, then you are from those who Allah mentioned, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about Prophet saying that inna qawmi takhadhu hadha al-Qur'an mahjura, that my people have abandoned this book. If you do not read it once a month, minimum once a month, you know, to read. If it's once a month or once a week, Sheikh Fawzan mentioned, I have to double check. The ulama, what they said, yeah, that minimum, that khalas, when you know, like, you know, that's it. There is no more excuse if you don't know. And what's it? And also, from abandoning the Quran to not implement it, to not judge by it, you know? And subhanAllah, even in Muslim countries, when they have abandoned the Quran, subhanAllah, humiliation being sent upon, Allah sent down upon us humiliation because we have turned away from the Quran. And this is the outcome of turning away from this book. This book that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down. And Allah, through this book, the Muslim ruled the world from the border of China to Africa to the border of Paris. Subhanallah. Ya akhi. Yeah, you read in English. If you don't, you can read the translation. Yeah, or listen to it. Listen to Quran. Listen to the recitation of the mashayikh, like my favorite reciter. I'm not sure if he's still alive. I haven't heard about him, Ahmed Al-Ajmi. Do you remember Ahmed Al-Ajmi? Who knows Ahmed Al-Ajmi here? Don't make me feel old, man. I'm younger. No, I'm younger, not old. You know him, Ahmed Al-Ajmi. He's a good reciter. To be honest, besides the new ones, especially the Shabab ones, some of them, I don't know what's going on with them, man. They use this technology, what is it they call it? The other tune, they change their voice and I like the old ones, my brother. I like the real ones, akhi. The Oh, Minshawi. May Allah forgive him. Al-Husri. Minshawi is Tartil. You know? Ma'al Mu'aqli, Al Hudayfi. MashaAllah. Listen, by reading it, try, of course. You get a double reward by struggling to read the Quran, even if you make mistakes. But we have to learn the Arabic language, my brothers and sisters. Now in our time, how many people from Somalia, Algeria, Morocco, Muslim countries, or even non-Muslim countries, they want to come to Europe to learn English language because they're interested in physics and biology? Because they know majority of research is being carried out in English language. So what they would do, they would struggle, do everything to learn the English language because they wanna get this, they get the information from the sources. What about the Quran? Was sent down to you from your Lord, the creator of everything. So you learn the language to understand it in its pure form. Even the Quran is a miracle in translation. Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah mentioned that. Like we, even the non-Muslims, when they read the Quran in the English language, he said it's a powerful book. I remember there was a young girl who came to us at our table. So I gave her a Quran, I said, go read it. So she, two weeks later, I think, we met her again. She came to us at the station, I asked her. She said, when I start reading, it's something very heavy about this book. She said, something heavy, very strong. I said, what do you mean by that? I wanna, like, what do you mean? She said, it's very heavy, I don't know how, but it feels like it's not from a human being. I said, of course, from God. Subhanallah. And I tell you this story happened to me personally. I remember in 2008 or something, I had a flat in White City. So I was going out, it was around midnight, it was just the day before Eid al-Adha, night before Eid al-Adha. So I went out to buy a burger from chicken shop. So I went, and there was this guy, Irish guy, who was in the shop asking for hotels. He says, because what happened, he cannot get a train back all the way to east, far east, because the train's closed down. I mean, train station's closed, yeah. So I said, okay, there is a hotel around the corner. He said, okay, thank you. So he left. On my way back to my house, I saw him. I said, what happened? He said, they charge a lot. I said, okay. I said, no problem. I said, come to my house, stay over. and tomorrow wake up and go. He said, oh, thank you very much. I took him to my house. So I was laying down and I said, listen to Quran. So he was listening to Quran. And he said to me, I was playing man mu'aqli. So he said, you know, something about this. What is this? I said, oh, this is Quran. He said, what is Quran? I said, this is like a, we believe this speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, you know, it's so powerful. He's like, I feel like I want to cry or something, yeah? So I said, maybe because Maher, he has a good voice as well. I said, let me choose someone like, you know, his voice is not that good. You know? So I chose another reciter because I have a channel, has different reciters, yeah? So I chose another reciter. So I said, Jimmy, what about now? He said, still the same. So alhamdulillah, I had leaflets, but I never seen his, have seen him again, you know? May Allah guide him. But the Shahid, even there's on YouTube channels, videos, when people go out and do the experiments, they tell people, come listen to Quran, and you see people crying. Subhanallah. So this book, subhanallah, one of the miracles of the Quran, as the Sheikh Saleh al-Sheikh mentioned, it has authority over the people's hearts. Or Sultan, authority. Yes, Akhi, you want to? Is it halal? Yes, but in a way, of course, if it's outside in the street and people there, you can speak to her. But it's better off to get a sister to speak to her. Or you bring her to a brother, like, you know, giving da'wah, so you speak to her. But even by messages, no problem, as long as there's no fitna. Shukban Baz mentioned something like similar to that. As long as it's better off getting in contact with sister or getting in contact with the masjid. But if there's no fitna, you send her information. That's it. That's no problem, inshallah. But if you think there is a fitna, then cut it off. So listen, there's a sister. Or if there's no sisters around, or that you are the only person, then you do it with the conditions that if you think that you're going to fall into fitna, stay away from that. Inshallah. Tafaddal akhi. The best translation of the Quran is Muhsin Khan. By Muhsin Khan and Taqid Din Hilali. Sahih International is okay, but the best one is Muhsin Khan. And Taqid Din Hilali.
Is it important to know the meaning of the Quran?
Yes, of course. For you to reflect upon the Quran, you have to understand the meaning of it. So when you are reciting Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, what is the meaning of Alhamd? You know? What is different between Alhamd and the Tasbih? Alhamdulillah means that you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that possesses perfect names and attributes, the one who deserves all thanks and appreciation and gratefulness and praises, yeah? Tasbih is you are glorifying Allah by saying Allah is far away from any imperfections. Any imperfections, Allah is far away from it. Alhamd, when you say Alhamdulillah, Alhamd means you are attributing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and describing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with that he has a perfect names and attributes and a perfect actions, subhanahu wa ta'ala, who possess perfect names, attributes, and actions. And when you say subhanallah, mean that Allah, saying Allah is far away from any imperfection. That's the alhamdu wa tasbih. Anyway, we'll stop here, inshallah ta'ala. Wallahu ta'ala, a'azu a'lam. Sallallahu nabina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in wa sallam taslima kathira. Barakallahu fiikum. وجزاكم الله خيرا